What's going on, YouTube? It's your boy Nick, back with Big Dogs Gotta Eat Fantasy Football. I realize I haven't done an updated rankings video in a while, and a lot has changed since the last time I put up, and that was probably a month ago. You know, the off-season's hectic, shit is always changing. So I figured I'd do an updated one. I have my top 100. I always do these rankings off half-point PPR. That's the leagues I play in, that's the leagues everyone should play in, to be honest with you. And that way it doesn't sway too much towards standard or PPR. Also, anyone play in a 1 point per first down rather than PPR? I've heard a lot of people starting to switch to those kind of leagues. I think that'd be interesting because the full point PPR is trash. It's like a running back gets a catch behind the line. You know the deal. So I'm going to switch over to my computer screen now where I have the rankings from 1 to 100. All the players, their position rankings, shit like that. And I'm going to talk about it for a little bit. So enjoy the video. Real quick plug. If you're looking for a fresh dad app for the summer, Big Dogs Gotta Eat got you covered. We got the pink. We got the blue, we got khaki, we got black, all this cool shit. So go check out the store, which will be linked in the description. And if you need any fantasy football gear for your league, Fantasy Jocks got you covered. I got the affiliate link down below. They got draft boards with all the player labels, stickers, championship belts, trophies, rings, all that good. Go check them out because their site is dope. They are the best in the industry. I can promise you that. This is not sponsored. I do have an affiliate link from them, but it's not sponsored. So go check them out. They are legit. I've been using them for like the last 3 years. All right, Playboys, here we have my top 100 rankings. I apologize if this is like in a weird format or it's kind of hard to read. I'm not going to go player by player because that's ridiculous. But also, if you haven't checked out Evan Silva's on Roto World, he does a top 150 list right now. Jots down a little sentence for each player, but definitely check that out. I'll link it in the description. Here's mine. Again, I'm not going to go through every player because it's out of control. I'm going to talk about some of the guys that I've been moving up or down, moving much higher or lower on since the last rankings. So my top 10 is nothing out of the ordinary. I will say when it gets to around like pick 15, I have Evan's a lot lower than the other wide receivers because I think for one, D-Jax is going to take a lot of those deep balls away. And I like Jay Ajayi over Jordan Howard by a long shot. And I think they're in two different tiers of running backs, in my opinion. I think Jordan Howard and Lamar Miller is a better argument than Jay Ajayi and Howard. I know the two are going around the exact same time. I don't like that Bears added a few receiving backs in the offseason, Benny Cunningham and their fourth round pick, Tariq Cohen. Jordan Howard drops a little bit for me. You see Joe Mixon and Larry Fitz really high up compared to where their ADPs are, where a lot of people are ranking them. My rankings are not, I don't go based off ESPN, Yahoo, even the Roto World. I do my own rankings, man. Like, if I think a player is going to bust out, I'm not going to conservatively put him at 50 just because that's where a lot of people put him. Like, I think Joe Mixon is going to be an RB1 because I think he's going to get all the early down work. I don't see Jeremy Hill taking any of that. It's taken for granted that Gio is going to be back, but the reports are saying he might not be back for the first couple of games. So I think Joe Mixon is a legitimate shot to be the workhorse there, and if that's the case, RB12 is like his floor. Fitz at 26, he's going, I know, in like the 40s in a lot of drafts. I don't think there's a safer player in this draft. He's back-to-back top 11 wide receiver finishes in PPR. Now the only competition he really has there for passes is John Brown coming back. Who knows if he's going to be fully ready to go? I mean, reports obviously there. I'm just saying Fitzgerald led the NFL in catches last year, and now he's a PPR monster. And I think wide receiver 13 is like right around where he'll finish, if not better. I think he's one of the safest players in this year's draft. So when it gets to like 30 to 40, that's when picks get a little interesting. It's players with, you know, have proven that they can have big years, but have a lot of question marks by them. I'm actually probably going to move D-Hop down a little bit. I don't think much has changed in Houston. Obviously, they drafted a quarterback and Brock Osweiler's out. But it's very similar setup to what they had last year. And it was just D-Hop, you know, having his big games, but not being able to be consistent. Same thing with him and Robinson. You see Keenan Allen at 38. Now, I know the argument here, obviously, he's a target monster, PPR monster. And I'm not only putting him here because I think he's a big injury risk, which obviously he is. What concerns me is those years that he had such big monster production, or at least when I know everyone likes to prorate it and just say, oh, he's going to be back healthy 100%, which probably will be healthy. Thing is, they were a totally different team when Keenan Allen was kind of blowing up. They didn't have Hunter Henry. They didn't have Melvin Gordon. They didn't have Terrell Williams. All these different pieces that are now a big piece of their offense is not what Keenan Allen had when he was the big part of their offense. You know, there's so many different dynamics to it that have changed that I can't just throw him into the top 10 at wide receiver again. So he's fallen pretty far on my board, and I wouldn't pick him any earlier than where I have him here, maybe 35. And you see Brady and Rodgers are like two of the earliest quarterbacks, and another quarterback's not picked till like 61 where Andrew Luck is going off the board. So I have Brady and Rodgers way ahead of everyone else in the tier because, you know, obviously they're Brady and Rodgers. They produce, they got the crazy weapons. I think I might even move Michael Crabtree up into the top 35 because he's way safer than Allen, Watkins, Jeffrey, possibly Landry. I like Landry, great floor, obviously, and always produces. The thing was, when Jay Ajayi started getting a lot of work last year, when he started getting a ton of carries down the stretch, you saw Landry's numbers dip a lot. So you saw his targets go down, his receptions go down, along with them bringing Julius Thomas, right? They didn't really have a tight end last year, so a lot of the over-the-middle targets only went to Landry, and I think he shares. I don't think Thomas makes a huge splash, but I think he takes a little bit away from the targets. That mixed with JGI being the centerpiece in the run more. Jarvis Landry, he has a good floor. I don't see a lot of upside. So those are some of the wide receivers there that are like questionable that I might be changing in my rankings. Another guy that I've been moving around a lot is Christian McCaffrey. When he first came out, I was like, this is it right here. I'm going to be way higher on McCaffrey than everyone else. Turns out everyone was really, really high on McCaffrey to the point where now his ADP is probably at... So McCaffrey is 35th off the board, running back number 14. So he's ahead of Marshawn Lynch, which I'm not going to co-sign. See, the two things I'm having trouble with on McCaffrey is, one, I'm not sure Jonathan Stewart just vanishes into thin air. I think he still takes a lot of the early down work, and he gets a lot of the goal line work. For as bad as he was last year, he still... I forget what the stat was. He was like top three in the league in yards after contact per carry. So he's still moving pretty well there. And I think he's not just going to disappear from the lineup. Also, Cam Newton is ranked like dead last in the league in terms of throwing to running backs. Carolina has never been a team that throws to the running backs. They have like the least receptions at the position over the last few years. Now, obviously, that's going to change because they drafted McCaffrey to be that guy. I just don't think... I'm a little nervous about his workload and about a few of those things. So I've been cooling on him a lot. I mean, he's not for a rookie running back. RB17 is not. You know, I don't hate him, but I don't think I could pick him inside the top 30 where a lot of people are going with him. What I think is a good idea, especially if you go wide receiver heavy, is when you hit that like where I have my rankings. I think it's like 52 to like 57, 58. From like Ty Montgomery down to Danny Woodhead or Eddie Lacy. I don't really like Lacy, but we'll talk about him here. Those are guys, I think Montgomery, Dalvin Cook, LeGarrette Blount, Frank Gore, Danny Woodhead, all with really either really safe floors or really high ceilings. So if you go wide receiver heavy off the bat, I think if you can grab two of these guys, which is definitely not impossible because Blount's ADP is so far away from everyone else's. Frank Gore and Danny Woodhead's is pretty high too. So even if you have to reach a little bit for like a Dalvin Cook or a Ty Mont, you could still grab these other guys later and have really solid running backs for, you know, the fifth, sixth, seventh round. And that goes the same for when I hit pick 59 for me, ranking 59 Brandon Marshall. Starting from there, I love Marshall. I don't love Sanders, but at pick 60 is fine for me. Willie Snead, Eric Decker, Quincy Enunwa, Crowder, Bryant, Terrell Williams, all monster upside. Everyone besides probably Decker. Marshall, in my opinion, hasn't lost a step. The Jets quarterback situation was just absolutely fucked last year. It was something like 44% of the balls that Marshall got last year, 4% of his targets were even deemed catchable. Nothing he could do about that, you know what I mean? Now he's in a better offense with the Giants, with a better quarterback. Obviously, a second fiddle to OBJ, but I still like Marshall to produce possibly double-digit touchdowns. I wouldn't surprise me at all. You have Snead with Brandon Cooks out of the picture. Snead's put up 900 receiving yards over the last 2 years, so his floor is really nice, and I think his ceiling is untapped. I think I'll probably end up moving him below Decker and Enunwa only because they brought in Teddy Ginn, so that takes away some of the deep potential he had, but I still think Snead, as that wide receiver too in Breeze's offense, who throws for 5,000 yards a year, has a super high floor and a really like an unknown ceiling that could be really nice. Decker, I think he leads the team in touchdowns. I think he's going to be very underrated because there's a lot of weapons there. Enunwa, there is no other weapons in New York, so he is the only guy there. Crowder is someone I've been creeping up my rankings. I really like Crowder. All the buzz out of camp is like really, really, really good. Coach Gruden just talks about how he's small, but he's still able to just like corral every single catch. Really long arms, which is good for a receiver, especially in the slot. Usually means they're able to go up and get balls even at their smaller size. You know, all the reporters are like, oh, he's going to lead the team in receptions and targets, which is definitely possible. He could easily be a 90 to 100 catch guy with Pierre Garçon and DeSean Jackson out of the picture. So I love Terrell Pryor and Jameson Crowder creeping up there. So those are like my mid-round guy. I also think, I didn't touch on Kelvin Benjamin. So Kelvin Benjamin, I tweeted about this yesterday. If you don't follow me on Twitter, go do that. Because I just tweet out little nuggets every once in a while. I don't tweet that often, but when I do, Kelvin Benjamin obviously had that crazy rookie year. He was like wide receiver 15 in PPR leagues. Then he tore the ACL. Then last year, he was wide receiver, I think, 25 And that was with the bad Cam Newton. I see last year as basically his floor. It can't get worse than it was last year, and he still surpassed 1,000 yards, right? He's going to be the number one in that offense. They don't have Teddy Ginn anymore. I just think Kelvin Benjamin actually, I know he's probably out of shape, and he's just like, it is what it is at this point, but I think his floor is really safe. So he's going pretty disrespectfully late. I think he's going at like wide receiver 31 or 33 or something off the board now. So he's a guy you can get in the mid to late rounds that is going to be the wide receiver one in an offense that we've seen play really well before. You know, so I think a lot of these mid rounds, the same thing could be said with if you go early running backs or early wide receivers. There's so much value in the middle rounds of this draft. And this is where a lot of these guys that you'll see here, their ADPs are a lot lower. And that's what I'm saying. I'm not scared to rank them here because these are the guys I believe will be the best value when it comes to your actual draft. I'm low on Tevin Coleman. I am not reaching for him. His efficiency numbers, when I talk about, I'm going to drop an updated bust video. I think Coleman's going to be on that. His efficiency numbers were just like out of control last year. They're just non-repeatable. He was not used in the 10-yard line, inside the five-yard line, rushing, receptions. Just not utilized in the offense the way that someone that you would, I think he's going around pick 50 or 55 right now. Not okay with that, all right? So I'm laying down the hammer on Coleman. And then as you go a little further down, it's guys with lower floors but high ceilings. Like touch on Stephon Diggs and my Minnesota Vikings outlook. Paul Perkins should be the guy there, but you never know. Doug Martin has a suspension. Rob Kelly again fighting with P. Ryan. I think Kelly takes a job, but who knows what's going to happen there. And a couple of these guys like Garcon, Meredith, John Brown, all guys I like later in the draft, like Pierre Garcon's linking back up with Kyle Shanahan. When they played together in 2013, he was the X receiver, and he should be it again. And he had he led the NFL in catches, had over 1,300 receiving yards. Cameron Meredith, I just talked about in my Chicago Bears outlook. One of 9 receivers in the NFL last year to have 5 different top 10 fantasy finishes. Wide receiver 17 in PPR from weeks 5 on. So really, really nice upside for a guy going so late. Johnny Brown, the sickle cell issue. Tons of upside with being the clear-cut wide receiver 2 there. Should be fully healthy. Quarterback. So, I have talked about Breeze being a little lower on my list this year. I just think the not having Cooks is going to hurt him. I think bringing in Adrian Peterson is going to hurt him. So, they're going to go a little more run heavy. And I just think missing the weapon of Cooks is going to hurt him a little bit. Like I said, it's not that I don't like Breeze, but I don't see the value in picking him at pick like 50 when you have a Matt Ryan or a Russell Wilson or a Cam Newton or a Marcus Mariota 50 picks later, right? It just doesn't make sense to me. I mean, in the rest of my rankings, you know, you could just check them out here. But I think the overall takeaways you could see when the 100 hits, I'm at wide receiver 46 and I'm only at running back 36. So I would say there's a lot more talent at wide receiver. It won't kill you to go heavy running back in the beginning because there's a lot of value at wide receiver. Only 10 quarterbacks in my top 100, 10 to 12 team leagues. You just that you only start one at each position, tight end or quarterback. You just can't value them the same as you value your skill position. So when I'm drafting, I always load up on flex players. So running backs, wide receivers, beginning and middle round. Sometimes I literally won't take a quarterback or a tight end until the 10th, 11th round. So I'll have 6 running backs and 4 wide receivers before I even touch another position. It's all up to you. This is just advice. Y'all can do whatever the fudge y'all want to do. These are my updated rankings. This will be up on a blog post on my site. So if you want to go check it out and have like a static picture of what they're like, go do that. I will be doing a top 250 rankings for my draft guide, which will be coming out in early August, so probably a month-ish from now. That will be included in there, so you can have like a print cheat sheet. It'll be like an e-magazine, like a PDF you could download, so you could print out as many versions of it as you want. If you enjoyed the video, please just scroll down a little bit and give it a thumbs up. And subscribe to the channel if you're new and you like this. Let me know what kind of videos you want coming out after this one. I'm doing a bunch of the team outlooks, obviously. Rankings, I'm going to do a couple more busts, mock draft, things like that. But let me know for sure. And I appreciate y'all spending your time with me. That's that. Adios.